And
Možeš ti preložiti na formu poslovnu. Šta je tam
Wherever there are
Ježiš,
the people, believers gathered in the name of Jesus,
láske,
and they are united in love, and there God gave a promise that He will be present there. That's the theme of this song, and we will sing it into Slovak language.
Tam, kde sú ľudia zídení, mene Ježíš, láske zjednotení. Práve tam Boh zasľúbil, že bude prítomný. Nezviem, že náš Boh je na tomto mieste prítomný. Privítajme Pána v tomto chráme, nech Mu Božia sláva naplní. Svojmu Bohu spievame a hráme, pieseň spasený. Privítajme Pána v tomto chráme, nech Mu Božia sláva naplní. Svojmu Bohu spievame a chráme, pieseň spasený. Všade tam, kde sú ľudia zídení, mene Ježíš, láske zjednotený. Práve tam Boh zasľúbil, že bude prítomný. Dnes viem, že náš Boh je na tomto mieste prítomný. Privítajme Pána v tomto chráme, nech Mu Božia sláva naplní. Svojmu Bohu spievame a hráme, pieseň spasení. Privítajme Pána v tomto chráme, nech Mu Božia sláva naplní. Svojmu Bohu spievame a hráme, pieseň spasení.
This is the song of those who are saved.
Wonderful.
Would you like please to read for me, John? Since you are American, you can read please the from John chapter 9, verse 1 up to the verse 12. It's good to read the whole chapter, but we want to save some time. So John chapter 9, verse 1 up to 12, please.
And as he passed by, he saw a man blind from birth. And his disciples asked him, saying, Rabbi, who sinned, this man or his parents, that he should be born blind? Jesus answered, It was neither that this man sinned nor his parents, but it was in order that the works of God might be displayed in him. We must work the works of him who sent me as long as it is day. Night is coming when no man can work. While I am in the world, I am the light of the world. When he had said this, he spat on the ground and made clay of the spittle and applied the clay to his eyes. And he said to him, Go wash in the pool of Siloam, which is translated sent. And so he went away and washed and came back seeing. The neighbors therefore and those who previously saw him as a beggar were saying, Is not this the one who used to sit and beg? Others were saying, This is he. Still others were saying, No, but he is like him. He kept saying, I am the one. Therefore they were saying to him, How then were your eyes opened? He answered, The man who is called Jesus made clay and anointed my eyes and said to me, Go to Siloam and wash. So I went away and washed and I received sight. And they said to him, Where is he? He said, I do not know.
Dobre rano. In Slovak means good morning. I bring you fresh greetings from the brothers and sisters in Slovakia, from my wife and my daughters-in-law. You know, everybody who knows that we will come here among you, they send special greetings to you. I would like to ask you a question. Can we find, a couple of questions, can you find the same story in other synoptical gospels? Can you find this story, the same story in other synoptical gospel? The answer is no. This is the only place you can read about the man who was blind from his birth. Okay, the only place in John. The other thing is, we don't know exactly where these things happen exactly. But when Jesus was with his disciples, they were walking, they saw this blind man. We don't know where exactly. And so, the question is, who was this man? Who was this man? We don't know what was his name. We know that he has a parents, and we know that he was in older age, which means he was able by himself to give answer to the people. If the people were asking questions, he was able to give them answer. So he wasn't like 5 years old boy, but he was probably maybe 20s, maybe 30s, we don't know, but he was enough old to give answers, we know from these scriptures. I would say that in this passage, we could see two types of miracles Jesus did. You know, first was the physical miracle, he opened the eyes of the blind. But the second miracle, he opened his spiritual eyes also. In order to open his spiritual eyes, he sick and he found the blind man, previous blind man, because he was now able to watch, and he revealed himself to him. And that's how his spiritual eyes were opened to him. So two types of miracles, and we will look these two miracles in his life. And so we will see that the second miracle is more important than the first miracle. Because those people who Jesus opened their eyes, physical eyes, they again died. They again closed their eyes. But those people who Jesus opened their spiritual eyes, they will forever see. You understand what I'm saying? It is why the second one is even more important. Okay, so let me look at the first miracle of the Lord Jesus Christ. But before Jesus opened physically the eyes of this blind man, his disciples raised a question. You know, and we as Christians, children of God, we all, sometimes we don't use this opportunity. We are not coming with questions to the Lord Jesus Christ. And especially when we have a good attitude, you know, asking questions. Because there were Pharisees, there were other people who came and asked Jesus questions, but with the wrong attitude, you know. they want to find mistake when they ask questions Jesus Christ. But the disciples ask him questions. And I would say from this passage we could learn this lesson. We, as a children of God, as God's people, we could come to the Lord Jesus Christ, ask questions. And Jesus wants to give us answer. He wants to give us a wisdom. He wants to give us knowledge, you know, let me put it that way. And so these disciples of the Lord Jesus Christ ask him a question, but their attitude, it's not very good, you know. Because it was judgmental kind of attitude. Who commits sin? They start to look. Who commits sin? Why this man is born blind? Probably in those days, you know, the Jews, they thought if someone is blind or somebody has a problem, maybe he or his parents committed sins. It is why now he has a problem. So, and it's interesting thing that Jesus' attitude toward the situations it's more positive than negative. When Jesus saw this man, he was thinking how God can manifest his power over this man. And when Jesus looked this man, they were looking on his past. The wrong things happened to this man, you know. And so, hallelujah, you know, our God, when he looks you this morning, he always look how positive things can bring in your life. And we people, sometimes we are not, when we meet a problem, when we face a problem, very often we think more about the past. Very often think that something is not possible. Very often we think more about focus on a problem, focus on other things, instead to focus on what God can do through this situation, through these difficulties, you know. Like Moses and the people of Israel, they came before the Red Sea, you know, they focus on the problem too much. They focus on the enemy. It's too strong. It's coming. It's very near. God said to Moses, what do you have in your hand? Use it. Use it. You will see things happening now, you know. And so this is the first principle what we could find, you know. The second principle, first is you have, as a child of God, you can ask questions to Jesus Christ. Jesus wants to give you answer. But the second thing is your attitude is also very important. With what kind of attitude you are coming to Jesus Christ, you know. Because even the Pharisees later, you know, when they ask the blind man, who did this miracle in Sabbath? Who did it? You know, they use a judgment, you know, judgmental attitude. But Jesus, you could see in this passage, he said that these things are for the glory of God, so that God will manifest his work, his power in the life of this man. It's a completely different attitude. And I will say that in those days, you know, the Jews had this kind of opinion that all the time when the problems, consequences are coming, you know, some illness, some other problems, is because somebody commit a sin. But can you imagine in Old Testament, like for instance, Miriam, the sister of Moses, you know, when she was speaking against Moses, the judgment came. And some people think like Gehazi, the servant of the prophet Elisha, you know, when he took things which didn't belong to him, he lied, and then the judgments of God came to him. But what we could say in the life of Job, why he lost his property? Why he lost his children? Why his illness came in his life? It was because of his sin? In this case, no. So not all the problems in all the testaments the people faced because of their sin. Sometimes it was so that God will glorify himself, you know. So that God will prove something, God will show something, you know. And so it is why in this case Jesus said, you know, this problem, it's not, he said, neither the man nor his parents seen it, said Jesus. But this happened so that the work of God might be displayed in his life. And so, but I would like a little bit to stop on this question. Do you know that this the question why there is evil in the world? Why unsaved people suffered? It's an old question. And maybe you sometimes, when you go through some troubles and difficulties, you ask yourself, why, Lord, I'm in a trouble? Or maybe you see somebody who is going through some problems and difficulties in life, you are saying, Lord, why he suffer? Why? And I would say that when we ask this question, why unsaved people suffer, or why there is an evil in the world, I would say that this is the this is Satan who is blaming God. He wants to put black things on God's character, you know. You know, if God is a good God, why then there is evil in this world? And if God is a love, why there are wars in the world? And so sometimes the devil wants to bring informations to the people, ideas to the people. Maybe God is not so good. It is why he allows evil things in the world. Or maybe God is not so powerful. It is why he cannot control the things in the world, you know. This is the way how the devil blames God, you know, put black things on God's character. So we know this question. I think you know this question, and we need to be fair that we don't know all the answers. And if God is giving on each question too much information, our Bible shouldn't be this small like we have it. It will be so big that you cannot even lift the Bible. So it is why God is not giving on each issue and each questions too much information, but enough information. So we could trust in our God and have confidence in him, you know. And so to those people who are using these questions to blame God, you know, sometimes I'm asking them questions. And the first thing is what I'm saying. That why God sometimes is allowing things to happen in our life is that he could use those problems, those tragics in our lives, so he could strengthen our faith in him. He could bless us so we could have more deep fellowship with him. I remember when we as a family, my children, you know, and we with my wife, we went through some trials and some problems. We experienced in those moments special grace. You know, when you don't go through trials, you don't need special grace. When you don't go to, when everything is okay, we don't need special power, special strength. But when you are going through some deep problems in your life, you could see how God is lifting you up, how he is giving you special grace to you. We need to have the needed courage. We need to have our faith. Sometimes I'm asking the questions to the people who are saying why there is evil in the world, to ask him, okay, let me put away God. Forget, let's say that God do not exist. Who you will now, who you will blame now? Why there is evil? Let me say for a few minutes, let's say put away God on the other side, you know. Who you will blame now? Why there is evil then? The people then don't know what to say. Of course, Satan don't want to be blamed. And the other thing is, if, let me say, tonight God decided at 10 p.m. to destroy all evil things in the world, how many good people will remain? Who is good? And so, you know, God knows what he's doing. And sometimes some problems are breaking us and changing, you know, our minds and our characters. And so, sometimes this is why God is allowing us to go through some problems, so he could change us. He could make us more pure, more to trust in him than in ourselves. And so this is, and then the last point what I'm sharing to the people who had this kind of questions, let us see how the evil was created. Who created evil? God? Of course not. The devil was the one who wanted, you know, to be equal like him. And so when he was separated from God and God created man, he wanted to touch, to hurt God's heart. to hurt God, to try to encourage the man to stand as a special creation, to stand up against the Creator. And God warned Adam and Eve. He said, don't eat from the fruit of the knowledge of good and evil. Don't eat. He warned him. It wasn't his plan, the man, to experience, to test the evil things. It is why he said, don't eat. It wasn't his will. It wasn't his plan to experience evil things. But the man decided to touch and to eat, to experience what is evil. So how the evil was created, it wasn't God's idea, it wasn't God's plan. God didn't want it for a people to experience evil things. But when the man decided, it is why there is evil now in the world. But God is not solving the evil like we think. He has his own plan. And we know, the Bible is telling to us, Revelation, it's telling that God will destroy the evil. There will be harmony. There will be no anymore disharmony, but there will be harmony in the future. And only those who had pure heart will go enter in harmony, because there is harmony where there in God's presence. And one day God will destroy this earth, destroy this heaven, will create a new heaven. Will create a new earth, and there will be no sin anymore in God's presence, and we will be with him in eternity. It is why we could trust in God today. We could be encouraged, you know, what God is doing, and have a right attitude when we go through some difficulties and we have some problems. We could ask God questions, but with the right motives, not with the wrong motives. Trying to criticize him, trying to find some problems, but really to have the attitude of Jesus Christ. He saw this blind man, he saw his problems, but he saw that God can do something in his life. And so it is why, after Jesus gave the answer to his disciples, Jesus came, he spit on the ground, he made some mud with salvia, and put it on his eyes. Okay, so the question is now, why Jesus did it? Why Jesus did it? Could he say to the blind man, open your eyes? He could say it, huh? It's more easy. Why he complicated the things? It's our question, yeah? But I will tell you, there are a couple of opinions why Jesus did it. And not all the time Jesus is, in some cases, Jesus touched the eyes to the people and he healed them and it happened. And this story, the story of this man, it's very similar like the story of Naaman in Old Testament. You remember the Naaman? The God, through the prophet, he said, go to the river of Jordan and 7 times you wash into the water. Uh-huh. So why he needed to travel? You know, he was even a little bit confused. Why I need to go? Jordan is unclean water, and we have Abana and Farfar, another 2 rivers in our country. They are more with clean waters. Why I need to go there? You know. But praise the Lord for his servants. They said, "Oh, Master, if he gave you harder task, you was able to do it. What if this is a simple thing, and you think it's unclean water, the river of Jordan, why you don't go there? Do it, do it." Why Jesus used this method? Why? Why he create the mud with salvia and put even more complicated his eyes? Because he was blind, but to put the mud was even more complicated for him to see. I would say that there are a couple of suggestions, you know. And I will tell you the last point in which I believe that this is a good explanation why Jesus used this method. And sometimes he used the same method to in your life to teach you something. The first explanation is that Jesus here is using his obrazna, It's a, like a picture, like a visual communication between him and the blind man. So it was like a communication, you know. He cannot see it, but when he put the mud on his eyes, Jesus start communication with him. I want to do something with you, you know. And so there was a like kind of communication. And the one thing what we could say that we know that the mud and the water in Siloam, the prayer or the church is not healing us. This is only symbolical stuff, you know. And sometimes God, Jesus is using symbols in order to catch our attention, in order to start to communicate with us, in order to raise up our faith in him, you know. Sometimes he is using this visual kind of symbols, things to start communication with us, communicational process. But whenever he is using this kind of symbolical things, like the mud, and sending him to go in Siloam to wash himself, it's he wants to increase his faith, to believe that he will open his eyes. So it was this method he's using. And I would say that faith which is not tested is not a real faith. And the faith of Naaman was tested. And the faith of this blind man was also tested. And so God, do God need a test? It's not the test for the teacher. The test is for the student. You're not professor. God is your professor, your student. He wants you to learn through examinations. So the test is for you. It's not for God. He knew what will happen. But the test is always for you to know where you are, if you really want these things or not, if you believe or you don't believe it, it will prove, the test will show. And so, in this case, sometimes God is using this kind of symbolical things in order to prepare you, in order to raise your faith and attention to him and trust in him. And you will then receive the needed healing. And so, now think about this blind man, how he could find where is the Siloam, the pool of Siloam. It wasn't easy, right? Probably he needed to ask other people. He was totally dependent on human help and so forth. And looking this place, exactly. What will happen if he went to the wrong pool? For sure, half obedience is not enough. Or partly obedience is not enough. He needed to trust what Jesus said. He needed to be 100% obedient. Exactly. He couldn't say, I don't need to go in this pool. Maybe there was another pool near, more near. He needed to be obedient 100%. And so sometimes we not forget this lesson. Don't think, I don't need to be 100% obedient. Well, if you are not obedient 100%, you will not see miracles in your life. You must be 100% obedient what God is asking you to do. God don't like partly obedience in our life. And sometimes why he allows us, he's using this kind of methods to teach us to trust in him. It's because he wants to train you, to teach you. And you are a student, don't forget, and he's your professor. And in this situation, we could see Jesus Christ really is teaching him. And the last thing what I could say is maybe through this he revealed himself. Do you remember who created this world? Jesus Christ. Do you remember from what material Jesus created Adam? Dirt. You see? So the mud represent God from the ground, or how do you say it? From the
dirt.
He made our body. Isn't this interesting? Including our eye. So he, maybe through this example, he is saying, I'm the master. I create the eyes, human eyes. I create your body. So this represents something, yeah? That I am the creator and I am the healer, the one who is the top above everything. And I will give you new eyes, new sight, physical sight. And so this, I would say that the gospel is revelation of Jesus Christ, who he is. And this morning, may God open our eyes to see, so that we could see who he is. Because this is the conclusion of John. Why John wrote a lot of miracles, what Jesus did, is so that we could come to conclusion and to have faith in him. That we will know who he is and we will believe in him. It is why I like to go through the miracles of the Lord Jesus Christ. And this morning, you know, we read this passage because it was the sign that he is the Messiah. No one was able in Old Testament to open the eyes of the blind people. No one. It was the sign that the real Messiah is the one who can open the eyes of, and especially for the guy who was blind from his birth. So there is no chance to do this miracle. And so Jesus, in this point, he revealed himself, who he is. He tested the faith of the blind man, but also his, let me put it that way, he revealed himself, who he is. And in the beginning, you know, this man, we don't know the name of this guy, but he thought maybe he is a prophet. He didn't have idea that he is the Messiah. So he received the sight, but he was spiritually blind. This guy, you know. And so he knew Jesus, because the one he heard probably that the one who sent him is Jesus. But he never met him. He didn't know him. He didn't know that he is bigger than prophet. That he is really the savior of this world. He is the Messiah. You know? He needed this revelation. And so you could see how he went to the pool and he washed himself and probably he was jumping. Hallelujah. I can see the green color. I can see the red color. I can see the sun. I can see myself. Finally, I want to see my parents, how they look. Maybe he has a relatives. His life was changed in one point, you know. And you know, brothers and sisters, I know that sometimes when we think we have one house, maybe we have two cars, that's not enough. Huh? But now, try to close your eyes and think if you will be blind the whole your life like this. How precious, how expensive is your sight comparing all the rich things in this world? I know a friend, I have a friend, gypsy guy, to whom I share Christ. He's blind. He's a very good musician, very good musician. And he did a lot of concerts and he earned a lot of money. He said, if the Lord brought me back the sight, I am ready to give everything what I have. You see? Sometimes we forget these things. But I would say that we could learn maybe this principle from this blind man. He depend 100% to other. And it is why Jesus said to in Matthew chapter 5, blessed are those who are poor in the spirit. Why the poor is blessed? Because he depend. Do you depend on Jesus? Do you have this revelation that everything you have is because of him? Not because of what kind of mind you have or what kind of talents you have. This is all gift from God, actually. He could be, you could be born blind, you know. So do you understand that all this thing, what you have, it's a gift from him? And the sight you have, it physical and spiritual, it's something so expensive, something so precious, that you could see things in this wonderful
things in this world, but not only this, that you could see the power of God. They could see the Savior, the one who created you, the one who created the whole universe. It's something I cannot describe, how precious it is to have this knowledge and to have this faith in Him, you know. And so this guy rejoiced. He was filled with joy because God changed his life. He gave him physical sight. And so he was brought, and when he returned back, his neighbors were not able to recognize him. They, you know, the people don't believe in this miracle. Some people think, you know, what they said for him. This, you know, he was brought before the neighbors, before his parents and the Pharisees, you know. And so it's interesting when, let me go back a little bit to the passage. Verse 8. His neighbors and those who had formerly seen him begging asked, "Isn't this the same man who used to sit and beg?" Some claimed that he was, some, not all of them. Others said, "No, he only looked like him." But he himself insisted, "I am the man." He brought problems to the people. The people, for them, was very hard to believe that he is the same guy who was a beggar. But he said, what a testimony. I am the same man. You saw him many days, you know, for many years. I am the one. So he's giving witnessing now, you know. He witnessed to other people. What a good witness. And even, you know, he argued with his parents were scared, because in those days, if the parents said Jesus healed him, they could be cast out from the synagogue. So they wanted to reserve their seats in the synagogue, not to lose the seats in the synagogue. That's why they were very wise. They said, "Ask him. He will tell you. Don't ask me." They were afraid, but ask him. So they had a fear, you know. We shouldn't have this fear, religious fear, from what the people will say to us. We should be, this is another example for us, you know. I remember the days when I was not yet born again. And even when I became a born again, in the beginning, the pressure, you know, the fear, what other people will say. I wasn't baptized as a bigger, I was baptized like a little boy. And so I wanted to be baptized, but there was a persecution. If I am baptized as a bigger, I will lose my membership from the church, you know, this kind of stuff. But I learned, and the Lord trained me enough, strengthened me to be bold and to say, I want to obey better God than to be afraid from people. And you see, this guy is not afraid what the Jews will say about him. And so God wants to encourage you this morning. Don't worry what other people will talk about it. For you, it's more important to think what God is saying to you. Don't be afraid of the people. Have the boldness of this blind man who was able to witness in front of his parents, in front of the Pharisees. He was no one. He was a simple beggar. He didn't even know. He never saw his parents before, how they looked. I don't know how he recognized them, maybe by the voice, you know. But can you imagine, in this situation, he was bald. Baldness is coming when God will touch you, when he will reveal you to you. You know, baldness is coming, like this guy. Then a good witness, fresh witness is coming. I don't care what you think, parents, about losing the chairs from the synagogue membership. I'm ready to say who did. Even this was in a Sabbath. In a Sabbath, suppose nobody to work. But Jesus did it in a Sabbath. And so the accusations now of the Pharisees, you know, how this man can be a real Messiah? He's working in Sabbath. It is why he is not Messiah. This is what the conclusion of the Pharisees. They said to him that he is a sinner. That Jesus is a sinner. But the blind man said, I don't know why you have this kind of debate, what kind of conclusion. But his question is, can God hear sinful prayer? If you Pharisees, you are saying to me that this man, Jesus Christ, is a sinner, then how God answer his prayer then? How he could proclaim this miracle then? And then he said, it was hard for them to believe. He said, I don't know what you are saying, but I know one thing. I was blind, but now I'm seeing. It was the strongest testimony what he gave. I was blind, but now I am seeing. This is the big proofment that Jesus is Messiah. So forget your doubts. The devil is using doubts and questions in order to destroy our faith. But he said, look to me. I was blind, and now I'm staying in your midst, and I'm witnessing. I can see. And this shows who he is, Jesus Christ. And so now they said, who are you to teach us? He became their teacher. The blind man, he became teacher of them. Who are you asked to teach? You know, they thought, we are teachers. Who are you to teach us all these arguments you are using, you know, to destroy our belief, you know, wrong belief. And so they cast him. They said, go away from us. And Jesus hear about it. And Jesus already revealed something from him in his life. He wanted to finish. He wanted to give more revelation. Because in opinion of this man, was still, maybe he's a prophet. He's a man of God. He loved God. You know, he prayed to God. God listened his prayers and so forth. He was thinking he's a prophet. But God, and why? Because his spiritual eyes were still blind. And Jesus wanted to do the second miracle to him. And so now, instead the blind man to search Jesus, who is who searching? Jesus is searching him. He heard what happened to him. This is, hallelujah, the good news. Instead, we to take initiative, he's taking initiative to us. He is searching us. What the time I need to finish? Because how much? Few more minutes? 2 minutes? Okay. To finish the message. And so, you could see that was the initiative of Jesus Christ. He came to search him. 9:35, chapter 9, verse 35. Jesus was searching him. The religious people reject the beggar. They cast him, but Jesus was searching him, and he found him. Praise the Lord. And so Jesus Christ is the one now who is questioning him, asking him a question. And not only asking him a question, but also he's revealing himself to him. He said, I am the one, Jesus. So God's plan is not to destroy us, but God's plan is to redeem us. God's plan is to open our eyes. And I would say that the Satan would like to turn down God's picture, but Jesus is bringing back, revealing himself as he is. And so I would say that the first miracle what Jesus did was a physical. He opened the sight of this man. But the second miracle Jesus did was he opened his spiritual eyes. And no one can open the spiritual eyes of the people, only Jesus Christ. And the reason why he could open your eyes, spiritual eyes, because once he opened your spiritual eyes, you will for eternity see. And even you passed away, you will receive a spiritual body. You will have a spiritual side and will remain for eternity. the physical, God can heal you. But the interesting thing, that the physical healing helped the man to get to know Jesus and to be open for Jesus Christ. In this case, and sometimes some people think that all the people, when all the people see miracles, all the people will be interested more Jesus Christ. In this case, only one man was interesting about Jesus Christ. The Pharisees, the neighbors, where are the neighbors? Why the neighbors are not saying, who, open your eyes, tell us where is this man? We want to find this man. Nobody can do this miracle. Where is Jesus? Miracle didn't produce this interest. The parents, instead to be bold and say, hallelujah, Jesus opened his eyes. We believe in Jesus, he is Messiah. No interest. They saw the miracle. No interest. What about the Pharisees? No, they wanted even to kill Jesus Christ. And so, brothers and sisters, don't be surprised even today. You preach the gospel and the people even can see miracles, but they don't believe it because they have similar heart of stone like these guys in those days. May the Lord bless you. Amen.